Cool J is hard as hell. Battle anybody, I don't care. You tell, I excel. They all fail. Gonna go to sales.
Good morning, top of the morning to everybody. I hope everybody's having a beautiful and blessed morning and ready to have a great day, man. Oh, man. Let's talk about this week, man. Let's go ahead and get into it, man. We had an amazing week of football, an amazing week 8. So let's go ahead and hop right into it. This is The Breakdown, X's and O's with Nate Ness. I'm your host, Nate Ness, and man, we're not like halfway done with the season, but we're like close to it. You know, we're like close, and we're getting closer and closer. Each game, each week, these games mean something. They're important. You got to continue to go out there and put your best foot forward. This is about separating yourself from the pack. Each game is about positioning now. As you move on, we're in November now. So, you know, you win those early games and, you know, in September and October and November, December, that's the positioning games. To separate yourself in the middle of the pack to get that high position in the playoffs. You know what I'm saying? Everybody wants to have home field, but let's go ahead and get into it, the importance of each game. Now, week 8, an amazing week. Now, we start off this week in MetLife Stadium. The Cincinnati Bengals go into New York to take on the New York Jets. Now, the Bengals are coming in, you know, just on cloud 9. And one thing I can tell you guys right now about playing this league is that anything can happen on any given Sunday. The Bengals just blew out division rival, the Baltimore Ravens, the week before. So you were expecting them to come in and just to continue that stellar play against a New York Jets team that's not really that good. But the Jets competed. Joe Burrow was marvelous. And that's, man, marvelous. 21 for 34, 259 yards, 3 touchdowns, 1 interception. Very active in the pocket. He made some very, very nice reads, nice plays, nice throws. Just looked really, really good, comfortable. Joe Mixon wasn't really that much of a factor running the ball, but he did carry the ball 14 times for 33 yards and had 1 touchdown. But he was big in the receiving department. 4 receptions, 58 yards, 1 touchdown. He accumulated for 2 touchdowns in a day. T. Higgins was a lead man in the receiving room. Had 4 receptions for 97 yards. But both Tyler Boyd and Ja'Marr Chase both had receiving touchdowns. And the Bengals defense wasn't really bad. Forcing 3 turnovers, 2 interceptions, and 1 fumble. But the Jets, I tell you, they were resilient. Battle back. Continued to battle back. No matter what was going on. Now, they had 3-year pro from Western Kentucky, Mike White, under center. He was filling in for the injured Zach Wilson. And I must commend him for his effort. I must commend him for the way he competed. He went out there. The opportunity was there. This game is about opportunities. When you get your opportunity, you've got to take advantage of it. And he looked good. Finishing the game 37 for 45, 405 yards, 3 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. He made some mistakes, but he battled through. And one thing that was actually very impressive and very, like, you know, noteworthy and you could notice it, the team rallied around him. The team rallied around him and just really, you know what, we got your back. Michael Carter actually provided some decent numbers in the running game, 15 carries for 77 yards and 1 touchdown. And the Jets had 4 receivers that recorded over 70 yards. That's spreading the wealth. That's good. That's really good. Michael Carter, 9 receptions for 95 yards. Jameson Crowder, 8 for 84. Ty Johnson, 5 for 71 and a touchdown. And Elijah Moore had 6 for 61. Not to mention Tyler Croft and Braxton Berrios. They both had receiving touchdowns. And the Jets were able to do the unthinkable. Yes. Knock off the Cincinnati Bengals, 34-31. Remember, anything can happen on any given Sunday. All right, next stop to Lucas Oil Stadium. We have an AFC South showdown. The Tennessee Titans travel to Indianapolis to take on the Colts. Now, the one thing that I've noticed over the years that this Colts team, this Colts and this Titans game, very competitive. It's not a one-sided affair. You get great competition. You get great competition from both teams. Ryan Tannehill was decent to say the least. You know, 23 for 33, 265 yards, 3 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. Quiet day for King Henry. You know, he didn't really, like, you know what, control the game running the ball like he has been the last month. 28 carries for 68 yards. Now, this Colts defense is actually pretty good. You know, nothing to take away from the Titans and what they've done, but, you know, the Colts have a really, really good defense, and they compete. But the big man was A.J. Brown. He strung along some consecutive weeks of just big play, dominating play. And yesterday was no different. 10 receptions for 155 yards, 1 touchdown on 11 targets. And the guy has just been playing just straight out big boy football. Jeff Swain and Nick Westbrook, they both had receiving touchdowns as well. Now, Carson Wentz, like Tannehill, you know what, was decent. 27 for 51, made some mistakes towards the end of the game that proved to be costly. Three touchdowns, two interceptions. Now, Jonathan Taylor, he didn't have the big game that what he's produced the last like 2-3 weeks, but he was effective. 16 carries for 70 yards, one touchdown. Michael Pittman was the big man for the Colts in the receiving game. 10 receptions, 86 yards, two touchdowns, as well as Jack Doyle, we're having a receiving touchdown as well. Now, these games have always been close, and they've been competitive, and this game was no different. They actually need overtime, and that's when Carson Wentz made a mistake, and the Titans were able to capitalize on that mistake and win a much-needed game, and a big game, 34-31. All right, next up, we're going to go ahead and head over to NRG Stadium, where the Houston Texans are hosting the LA Rams, and the red-hot LA Rams at that. Matthew Stafford, let's take a second to just really look at what he's doing. He's putting up MVP numbers. You know, he's playing at an MVP caliber rate, and he's a candidate for the MVP. And he looks refreshed. He looks, you know, confident and just having fun all over again. And he's on pace to have career numbers, career year in numbers, and as far as passing yards and in passing touchdowns. Barring any injuries or anything, and they continue to play good, I expect Matthew Stafford to really just continue to have a breakout year and be in the chase and in the running for that MVP. Yesterday, no different. 21 for 32, 305 yards, three touchdowns. Him and Sean are on the same page. They're on the same wavelength right now, and that's scary right now. With that offense and what that offense can do and provide, the weapons that he has, it's scary. Now, they got great production on the ground. Darrell Henderson led the way with 14 carries for 90 yards. Robert Woods also got in the mix with three carries for 22 yards and one rushing touchdown. And Cooper Kupp, consistent Cooper Kupp, another big week. He's having an all-pro season. Seven receptions for 115 yards, one touchdown. Robert Woods and Darrell Henderson also had receiving touchdowns. And the Rams defense, they did what the Rams defense do. You know, recorded 5 sacks and 1 interception. But this Texans team, they still have rookie Davis Mills under center, and they're hoping to get Tyrod Taylor back within the week or so. But he fared okay. 29 for 38, 310 yards, 2 touchdowns, 1 interception. Now, the caveat to that is that a lot of his work came in the fourth quarter when the Rams took their foot off the gas. Now, that's no excuse for the Rams to take their foot off the gas because, again, the game isn't over until it's 0-0-0 on the clock. But I respect the competitiveness of the Texans and continuing to fight and fight no matter what until the game was over with. There was no excuse for the Rams to take their foot off the gas, but I respect this Texans team. Rex Burkhead had a rushing touchdown, and Brandon Cooks, 6 receptions, 83 yards, 1 touchdown. He's really been the only consistent playmaker for this team since the year began. But the Rams get a big one and an important one. And remember what I said, this is an important game for each team going forward. Seeding, positioning. They get a big win, 38-22. All right, to First Energy Stadium. That's our next stop. We've got an AFC North showdown. The Steelers travel to Cleveland, the Midwest, to take on the Cleveland Browns. Now, this is a low-scoring game, a defensive game, my type of game. And this is what the Steelers are good at. They can get back to their winning formula. See, the Steelers' formula is playing really good football, having a great defense, rushing the ball and controlling the clock, and just really the quarterback controlling the game. Big Ben, he was solid. You know, 22 for 34, 266 yards, one touchdown, no interceptions. Now, you need that. You just really need. You don't want to put too much on Ben's plate. You know what? And it's going to be big going forward. From this point forward, if the Steelers are going to make any push for postseason play, Najee Harris has to take off. And he had a great game. He had a good game. He took pressure off Ben, getting some tough yards, 26 carries for 91 yards and one touchdown. Now, Deontay Johnson was the leading man in the receiving room with 6 receptions, 98 yards. And Pat Freiermuth, please forgive me if I messed your name up. Please, Pat. He had a reception touchdown. And the Steelers, they was getting back to the formula, what has been successful for them in the year earlier years, and that's playing great defense. And the defense smothered the Cleveland Browns. Baker Mayfield didn't really do much. 20 for 31 for 225 yards. Nick Chubb was in his first game back, but the Steelers made an emphasis to really not allow him to take over the game, in which he has in the weeks. He's actually ran hard this whole season and really had points where he's taken over the game. He had 16 carries for 61 yards. And D'Ernest Johnson had a rushing touchdown. Now, if I can go off script for a little bit, D'Ernest Johnson, it's going to be big for him to step into that role that Kareem Hunt had. Because you don't know necessarily how long Kareem Hunt's going to be down for, but it's going to be big for him to step up, and he's going to have the opportunities. You know what? You've got to take advantage of it. This Browns team is relying on the running game. And when teams are just really loading the box and doing all these things to try to stop Nick Chubb, that's when you come in and you change the dynamic of the team. Or excuse me, the game and whatnot. You add another element and dimension. So you got to get to it. Jarvis Landry was really the only Browns receiver to have over 50 yards. And he had 5 receptions, 65 yards. But this was about the Steelers. And the Steelers getting back to Steeler football and getting a big division win, 15-10. All right, to my old stumping grounds, Ford Field. Ugh. The winless Detroit Lions. Now, they're trying to get one win to get in the win column and just to, you know, just to get the confidence in the building. You know, they host the Philadelphia Eagles. Now, the Eagles dominated this game from the opening kickoff. And Jalen Hurts, you know, really didn't have a big game passing. As you can see, 9 for 14, 403 yards. And it really wasn't needed to. He carried the ball 7 times for 71 yards. But the production came from running backs. Boston Scott, who had 12 carries for 60 yards, 2 touchdowns, and Jordan Howard, 12 carries for 57 yards, 2 touchdowns. That's where they got their production from. You know, that's where you got your production from. There was no receiver on the Eagles' offense that had more than 20 yards. Dallas Goedert had 6 receptions for 72 yards. But the Eagles' defense, and let me go ahead and reiterate that, the Eagles' defense, they dominated. They sacked Jared Goff 6 times. And Goff didn't really have much of a pocket. He finished the game 25 for 34, 222 yards. But Jamar Jefferson had a rushing touchdown, but that was in cleanup time. T.J. Hockenson, he was probably the only bright spot. He had 10 receptions for 89 yards, but the Lions got to get back to that drawing board. They got to get back to the drawing board and figure out what it is that can help the team and just really capitalize it. You know, for every game that they played in, even though they're winless, they've competed in every game. They have not just went in there and laid down. They have put up a fight. But yesterday, the Eagles dominated them from the opening kickoff, 44-6. So hopefully, guys, y'all can get it right. All right. We're going to go around the corner to Soldier Field, where the San Francisco 49ers take on the Chicago Bears. Now, the 49ers, they got back on track. Jimmy G was solid in the passing game, 17 for 28, 322 yards. But when you think of the 49ers, but let's just not say the 49ers. Kyle Shanahan is their head coach. When you think of Shanahan, you think of zone running. You think of running the ball, controlling the clock, running the ball. If you go back and look at those Super Bowl Bronco teams, the 97 and 98 Broncos, they controlled the game with the clock and running the ball with great rushing with Terrell Davis. Nothing no different here. You know what? Eli Mitchell had a big game. Carried the ball 18 times for 137 yards, 1 touchdown. And Jimmy Garoppolo also had 2 rushing touchdowns on the day. But in a passing game, Deebo Samuel was big. He was a bully. He was Deebo. You know, 6 receptions for 171 yards. And just really making play after play. Now, the Bears weren't really bad. Justin Fields had a productive game, 19 for 27, 175 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. But he also carried the ball 10 times for 103 yards, 1 touchdown. He's giving you flashes of what he can do. He has great potential. He has great talent. Now it's time for him to just, you know what, he's in his rookie year. He has to learn the NFL game. As you come into the NFL game, it's not college. It's quicker. You gotta really get in that playbook. You got to understand. He got to learn to be a better pocket passer. He got to use his natural abilities and just tie that into more technique and all else things. You know what I'm saying? He's going to be a great quarterback in this league. Khalil Herbert, he had a quiet day, but he ran hard, 23 carries for 72 yards. And Jesse James had a reception touchdown. But this game was close. Again, this game was close all the way up until the fourth quarter. Chicago was controlling the game all the way up until the fourth quarter, where the 49ers erupted for 18 points, and they take an important game, 33-22. All right, to the Mercedes-Benz Stadium. That's like right down the street from me, like right down there. But the Falcons host NFC South Division rivals, the Carolina Panthers. Now, the Panthers, they've had a rough spell. They started off the season extremely hot. Sam Darnold was playing at a high rate. They started off 3-0, but they have, you know, had a rough patch as of late. Now, Darnold, who, you know, has had a couple of rough outings, he wasn't horrible, but he wasn't great. You know, his numbers, he was mediocre. 13 for 24, 129 yards, 8 carries for 66 yards. And Chuba Hubbard was the bell cow. You know what, 24 carries for him, 82 yards, and 1 touchdown. And DJ Moore was quiet. He was the lead man for the Panthers, 4 receptions for 59 yards. But this is about the Panthers' defense. The Panthers' defense showed up and played very well. Stephon Gilmore, the newly acquired cornerback from the Patriots trade, had an interception. And the Falcons have been playing some good ball up until this week. You know, they had their struggles earlier in the season. And Matt Ryan was playing better the last, like, 3 weeks, consistent, really good football. But he had a rough day yesterday. You know, going 20 for 27, 146 yards, one touchdown, two interceptions. And the Falcons couldn't really – they couldn't really find no identity on offense. They couldn't find, like, you know, no rhythm in a passing game. They couldn't find nothing. They didn't even have a rushing attack. So it was one of those rough games. And the Falcons were without Calvin Ridley, who was stepping away from football to concentrate on his mental health. Now, I'm going to pause and talk – about this, because this is important. Outside of playing football, we're men, we're fathers, we're husbands, and it's important for us to be able to not just, you know, to provide a spark or to play on the field, but we gotta, you know, when we go home, we're family men. We have people that are we're human, just like anybody else. We put our pants on one leg at a time. And Calvin, bro, hey man, take care of yourself, man. Get to a place where you need to, and I'm praying for you, and you know, you get the help. And that you can, you know, you get the help that you need and just really get to a better place mentally, man. And I commend you for taking this time, you know, for just, you know, taking it for yourself and just really not being ashamed of it, man. So prayers and love to the Ridley family, man. Big time. That's important. But back to the game. Tajae Sharpe was the high man for the Falcons. 5 receptions for 58 yards. And Cordarrelle Patterson had a reception touchdown. But this game was about the Falcons, and I'm going to point some things out, their inability on offense. The Falcons were 3 for 10 on third down. The Panthers, 10 of 17. The Panthers won time of possession. You know what? 35 minutes to the Falcons, 24 minutes. Not being able to extend drives and be the Panthers being able to hold on to the ball. They had also, you know, won in total yards. The Panthers had 332 yards while the Falcons had 213. Those are not, like, you know, that's not a winning formula right there. That's a formula where you're going to lose the game. And guess what? The Panthers came in and got a big and much-needed division victory in a low-scoring game, 19-13. All right. Let's go to our next stop. All right, to Highmark Stadium. My old team, Miami Dolphins, traveling in to take on the Buffalo Bills. And this has been a tough season. This has been a tough season for the Dolphins, and I extend my hat especially to Tua Tagovailoa. For him to be a consummate pro, with all of the rumblings about being traded and here and there and this, that, and the other. And you've still been the consummate pro, brother. You've still went out there and competed and tried your hardest to win games. You know, and I salute you for having tough skin, because this game could chew you up and it could spit you out. But with all of that noise, he's continued to not let that affect him. He's continued to just go out there and try his best to help his team win. Now, he had a rough day against a good Bills defense. 21 for 39, 205 yards, one interception, but also had a rushing touchdown. And the Dolphins, again, something I've been saying for weeks and weeks and weeks, that the Dolphins can't expect to help this young quarterback if they can't establish some type of running game. You can't be a one-dimensional team. You've got to have something else. And 68 yards as a team, it's not going to cut it. You got to get better in that department. Devontae Parker had a decent game, 8 receptions for 85 yards. But let's talk about the Bills. Josh Allen, their MVP candidate, continued his MVP caliber play. 29 for 42, 249 yards, two touchdowns, and 8 carries for 55 yards and a touchdown. He accounted for 3 on the day. Cole Beasley had a big game on the offensive side, 10 receptions for 110 yards. And Stephon Diggs and Gabriel Davis both had reception touchdowns. And the Bills get another important division win against an opponent, 26-11. Come on, guys, man. Y'all got to get better, Miami. Come on. All right, to SoFi Stadium. Now, this was my favorite game of the day, the New England Patriots. They flew into town to take on the LA Chargers. Now, the Patriots weren't flashy, yet they played a game that was very reminiscent of how they, you know, they played and won games in the earlier stages of the dynasty. Mac Jones was mistake-free, 18 for 35, 218 yards. The Patriots got big production from the running backs, collectively rushing for 131 yards and a touchdown. Leading the way was Damian Harris, who rushed the ball 23 times for 80 yards and one touchdown. Nelson Aguilar was a high receiver with 3 receptions and 60 yards. It was on the defensive side that the Patriots showed up and showed up big. 2 interceptions by Adrian Phillips, with him returning one for a touchdown. And Justin Herbert, he had a rough day compared to like the weeks before when he's just been lights out. But that 3 week period when he threw 11 touchdowns, no interceptions, he was lights out, but he had a rough day. And I know he's gonna, he wants, it's some throws that he wants back, but it's okay. It's a learning day. Yesterday was a learning day. And it's gonna, when you watch the film, it's gonna be a great learning lesson. He finished the day 18 for 35 for 223 yards, 2 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. Austin Eckler had some good production. 11 carries for 64 yards, one touchdown, and six receptions for 60 yards. Keenan Allen also had a good day, a decent game, to say the least. Six receptions for 77 yards, one touchdown. Josh Palmer also had a monster 24-yard touchdown towards the end of the game where he mossed one of the defenders. But this is a good game, and when I mean good, I mean competitive. The Patriots actually, you know, again, this game was reminiscent to how they've won games before with a solid defense and collectively on offense as a team, a collective win. And they get a big win at that against a quality AFC opponent, 27-24. All right. To the 12th man, Lumen Field, where the Seattle Seahawks host the Jacksonville Jaguars. Now, Trevor Lawrence wasn't really bad today. You know, wasn't bad. 32 for 54, 238 yards, one touchdown, one interception. And the Jaguars, they really didn't have a rushing attack, but Carlos Hyde, he led the way, nine carries for 32 yards. Jamal Agnew had a receiving touchdown, and Dan Arnold led the way for the Jags, eight receptions for 68 yards. But the Seahawks, this was about the Seahawks and them getting back on track. See, we've never seen Seattle winless at home. I can tell you right now from experience, playing in Seattle is one of the hardest places to play at. With that crowd and that, like, you know, the energy of that crowd, you know, the Hawks feed on that, but they're winless. But they got back on track. Geno Smith was very good, efficient in the pocket, and just had a very, very good day. 20 for 24, 195 yards, two touchdowns, and also had a rushing touchdown. He accounted for three touchdowns, and that was great production. Great, great numbers right there for Geno. So great job yesterday, young brother. Alex Collins had 44 yards on the ground on 10 carries, but this game was about Tyler Lockett. Tyler Lockett has had a quiet year up until this point. You know, you were just waiting for when he was going to have his breakout game. Yesterday was his breakout game. 12 receptions for 142 yards. Man. But DK Metcalf also had made some big plays. Six receptions for 43 yards and two touchdowns. The Seahawks were able to play a complete game and finally get a win at home in front of their home crowd, 31-17. All right. To the mile high we go. The Washington football team plays the Denver Broncos. Now, this was another one of those low-scoring contests, but one of those defensive games I love. Taylor Heineke wasn't his best yet. The Washington football team was in this game, was in it throughout. He finished the game 24 for 39, 270 yards, one touchdown, two interceptions. Now, Jared Patterson led the way on the ground, 11 carries for 46 yards. And running back J.D. McKissic had a big game receiving, eight receptions, 83 yards. And DeAndre Carter had three receptions for 51 yards and a touchdown. You know what? The full Washington football team was in this game. You know, it was a close game, but they were in it. Teddy Bridgewater, he had a decent day. You know, it didn't have big numbers, but he didn't make any mistakes. 19 for 26, 213 yards, one touchdown. And Melvin Gordon got going with 10 carries, 47 yards, and one touchdown. Tim Patrick was the only receiver to have over 50 yards for the Broncos as he had three receptions for 64 yards. But this is about the Broncos defense, and the Broncos defense stepped up in a big way and gave Washington problems, getting four sacks and two interceptions, and winning the game 17-10. So congratulations to the Broncos. All right, to the Superdome we go. Man, Sunday Night Football. Man, an amazing game. An amazing game. Well, this wasn't Sunday Night Football, but this was a nice matchup, excuse me. The NFC South between the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, excuse me, guys. Tampa Bay Buccaneers and the New Orleans Saints. Now, this game was the opposite of how I really pictured it going. But that's why I said anything can happen on any given Sunday. Tom Brady had an uncharacteristic game. Just a rough game. 28 for 40, 375 yards, four touchdowns, two interceptions, and he lost a fumble. Now, that's very uncharacteristic from the greatest quarterback of all time to giving the opponent the ball three times. The Bucs didn't really have no rushing attack, but Chris Godwin had a monster game. Eight receptions for 140 yards, one touchdown. Mike Evans, Giovanni Bernard, and Cyril Grayson all had reception touchdowns. But this is about the Bucs and just really playing the off game and the Saints defense stepping up in a big way. Jameis Winston had an early exit with a knee injury, and I'm praying for just a speedy recovery and everything is okay, brother. But before he left, he was 6 of 10 for 56 yards and one touchdown and four carries for 40 yards. He played pretty good. You know, he's playing pretty good. He wasn't out there, you know what, playing hero ball. You know, he's mistake-free and just really concentrating, focused, and locked in on the game. But in comes Trevor Siemian, who had a good game in relief duty. 16 of 29, 159 yards, one touchdown. Alvin Kamara had a great game as well, carrying the ball 19 times for 61 yards and one touchdown. Traquan Smith and Alex Armour both had receiving touchdowns, and the Saints defense stood up in a big way, forcing three turnovers and scoring on defense. But the way they limited this Tampa offense, and this Tampa offense, this is a Super Bowl offense. This is a Super Bowl winning team, and that's returning everybody. They got a big win, and you know what? They answered some questions. Like, as a team, the Saints answered some questions on Sunday, and they get a big win, 36-27. All right. Now we get to head Sunday Night Football. All right. U.S. Bank Stadium. Minnesota Vikings host the Dallas Cowboys. And this game was exciting and a quality matchup. Dallas comes in into this game on a six-game winning streak, having lost since the opening week on Thursday Night Football to the Bucs. But they come into this game without their starting quarterback, Dak Prescott. So Cooper Rush got the nod. And he looked rather good, and he finished the game very well. 24 for 40, 325 yards, two touchdowns, one interception. I mean, I really couldn't tell that he was a backup, you know, other than knowing mentally, like, you know, hey, Dak's not playing. But this guy, he had complete control of the offense and the way he commanded the offense. Man, Ezekiel Elliott had a quiet night, but you know what, 16 carries for 50 yards. Now, the thing about this Cowboy offense is, Zeke had a quiet night, but you got to contain them receivers. And them receivers showed up and showed out in a big way. Amari Cooper, 8 receptions, 122 yards, one touchdown. And he had to go ahead touchdown with 51 seconds left in the game. CeeDee Lamb, 6 receptions for 112 yards. He had a couple of drops, and CeeDee, you got to clean that up, but another big showing. Cedric Wilson, big play said, 3 receptions, 84 yards, one touchdown. All of them showed up and showed out in a big way for Mike McCarthy and this offense. And, man, on the other side, the Vikings weren't bad, yet they weren't the Vikings we've seen since week one. Kirk Cousins didn't have the numbers that we normally been seeing from him. He went 23 for 35, 184 yards, one touchdown. Didn't have the big numbers, like I said, but he didn't make any mistakes. Dalvin Cook, 18 carries for 72 yards, and that was a focal point for the Cowboys' defense, was to limit him from making any big plays and not allowing him to dictate and control the game. Adam Thielen, 6 receptions for 78 yards and one touchdown, was a high man in the receiving department. As Justin Jefferson had a little injury. He had a quiet game, but he had a shoulder injury. But he came back in, but wasn't really targeted that many times. The Vikings played a good game, and they took the lead. But the Cowboys, again, they made plays. They made plays throughout the stretch of the game, and they continued to battle and battle and battle. And they get a big win. And the importance of this win is that Dak was able to rest. And they still went out there and took care of business. A big win, 20-16. Man, week 8 was just an amazing week. Again, anything can happen on any given Sunday. And we've seen that with Tampa Bay and with Cincinnati. But also, week 8 and going forth is very important when it comes to, you know what, separating yourself from the pack. All these games are important. You win games in September and October to position you in the games in November, December, leading to January. It's all about positioning and everything. Everybody that's going for postseason play, each game is important. So it's imperative that players take the film session serious. When you go home, get an extra 30 minutes of film, extra 45 minutes of film. Be ahead of the game. Know your opponent. If you are passionate about playing and being a championship team and being a championship all-pro player, you gotta be all in. You gotta be wired to the game. You know, wired to it. Continue to push yourselves to get better. And this is an important time for you to take care of yourself mentally, emotionally, and physically. The game is a long season. It weighs on you. It weighs on you. Make sure you're in the place that you can compete and compete at your highest level. Continue to go ahead and put the best foot forward and continue to compete. Man, another great week of football. I'm just so appreciative of it. Continue to work hard, fellas. And guys, everybody, thank you for tuning in and thank you for spending some time with me. And until we meet again, this is The Breakdown, X's and O's with Nate Ness. Thank you, and everybody, y'all have a beautiful and blessed day.